welcome to another episode of Behind the Sport. How are you doing today, Brent?
Yeah, good, mate, good. What episode are we up to? I can't even remember. I should count and read that before I actually get into it.
Yeah, look, I don't remember.
I think we're four, season two? Five, season two.
No, we're past episode five.
Six.
Sure. Yeah, so we did out of Marjoram.
Tom.
Trengove.
Ducky.
This is really bad. Mark Rossiter. Sorry,
yeah.
Roysiter.
Roysiter. And Mark M-R-A-C.
Yes. Yeah. So this should be episode six.
Not M-A-R-K, as I keep writing to him in emails.
I think I might just double check because, you know.
It is because Mark was the last one. Yeah, so we're talking about the upgrades and stuff.
Yeah. But, you know, I wouldn't want to upset any of our guests, so I'm going to quickly look on the phone.
That's so bad.
It would be.
It's because we're not organised like normal.
Well, we're never organised. I don't know what you're on about. Meanwhile, our guest that's sitting here just going, what the hell is he getting himself in for? Ian Board, how are you doing?
Not too bad. Thank you very much for having me on.
Not a problem. Just going
to
quickly...
Ian's about to learn the magic of post-editing.
Yeah, no, I'm going to leave all this. I'm going to leave all this in because...
It shows that we're human.
It's all the fun.
And
yeah.
We're not so trim and prim and proper. Like yeah, and everyone try to pretend they're rock stars. And
everyone thinks, you know, like this just goes off a hitch without a hitch every time. And
I don't know.
We've missed a guest. We've missed a guest. This is really bad. Who did we miss? Denver Parker.
Oh, yeah, Denver last week. Yeah, that's good. Oh, yeah, I love you, Denver. But because I talk to you every week anyway, I didn't even think of it.
Like, all the time and effort we took to get him on, and then...
Yeah, he's just so casual and low-key, you know. Yeah. There's no stress, there's no build-up. It wasn't like Ducky where I had a heart attack on the intro.
Did you?
Yeah, well, you know, I had to call Scene a couple of times.
Yeah, but that was because Ducky was quacking from places unknown. Anyway.
Denver, you are so smooth.
Sorry, Denver.
Mr. Brosnan himself.
Yeah.
Yeah. Wow.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. Well, that's 2.5 minutes that we'll never get back. Sorry, people. Ian, are you still the president of the Junior Dragsters?
I've never been the president.
Okay.
I'm on the committee.
You're on the committee, okay. My apologies.
No, that's all right. Dougie Green's our president.
Sorry, Doug.
So that might, well, things will change shortly. We've got our AGM on Sunday. Yep. And
well, maybe by the time that goes to where you might actually be
president.
Yeah, maybe we're seeing the future here.
I think you might be seeing something.
All right.
So, yeah.
Oh, there's a major coup there. Way off.
Yeah. Okay, so what do you do with the Junior Dragster Association?
So I do a lot of behind-the-scenes stuff, helping out with their fundraising, organising their club tent and the equipment and that. The junior buggy and, you know, the starter carts and all the stuff that we are very privileged to have as part of our Junior Dragster Association that we're the only ones to have, like, Australia-wide. We've travelled across Australia and, very blessed to the people in the past that have put this club together for the kids and, we've got some assets and some stuff that a lot of clubs don't have or if they have clubs at all.
Yeah, okay. How long has the association been around in Western Australia?
Now you're testing me. I believe it's around 15 years old, 10, 15 years old.
Yep.
Wow. Yeah.
Okay.
So, might be a bit longer.
And how many junior dragsters did you have racing last season?
Last season, I think we're up to about 16 again. So the numbers are slowly creeping back. So it's getting stronger and stronger. And we had no one age out this season.
Okay.
So Zara's the next one to age out after this year, I think we've got two or three coming up. So we'll be nudging close to 20 juniors this season, so looking forward to that.
Madison Brown, she aged out the year before.
She aged out the year before.
Yeah, she's a bit of a beast. I was watching her, like, interacting with her dad on race day, and it's a lot wondering who's the team boss there, and it sort of seems to be Madison.
Same at our pit, you know, daddy's little girls, I suppose. they've got us wrapped around their finger.
Yeah. It was interesting, though, because it's I do a lot of stuff within circuit racing, and at a recent circuit meet, and I will not mention the kid's name, but it's very well. I think it's very well known who it was by now. You know, like, things happen in races, and he decided to come off the track, hit the wall, reverse, come back on, got pulled into the steward's office to, you know, get checked on, not stewards, the scrutineers, to get checked out. And instead of going, yeah, okay, thank you very much, you know, like, we'll listen to you, just started going off at him, and I'm going, well, holy crap, you know, like, in the, and I've only been around drags for, you know, like, the 6 months or something that they gave me my access last year, and, yeah, never saw any of that. And then this kid, like, even turned around to his dad and started going off at his dad and swearing at his dad, telling him to fix it and that. Like,
wow.
Is that something you guys see in the junior drags?
Absolutely not. And I think it's something I'd be stamping out pretty quickly. Zara would be sitting the next couple of meets on the sideline, short and sharp, to learn a lesson. I think the great thing about our dragster association, and that is how well-behaved and well-mannered the kids are, and I think that also helps the club in the way that they get a lot of support from other races and the community and a few little businesses that chip in and sponsor them. It's fantastic, and, like, yeah, we're really proud of the kids there. They can't do enough for each other or for others to help out.
So we were down there doing some video and photos and stuff, and it was amazing to see the interaction, you know, at such a young age already, with cameras being shoved in their faces, you know, usually, you know, around that age, they're either hamming it up or they're shying away, and, you know, we're getting thumbs up and all sorts of stuff. Is that something you teach them, or is that just their personalities?
I think it's their personalities. I mean, a lot of it this day, they've got their camera phones and selfies and all that sort of thing. So there's a lot of that, but they there's nothing to be in one pit, you know, like on our corner, and Sonia's feeding 10 or 15 juniors, you know, eating all my plum pork ribs or something like that, and get back to the pits and, yeah, missing out.
We're in the wrong pits.
Yeah.
Yeah, the dragsters do it well. Slow cookers and air fryers and that, they're the way to go, eh?
In a sort of an American-inspired sport thing, because the Speedway boys do the same. It's not unusual, especially at the big shows, to see, you know, the slow cookers in each truck, or, you know, the Priolos with a spit on a bigger night. Oh. You know, like, it's kind of good.
And the giant
lolly jars.
Yeah.
I hope they bloody give me my accreditation this year. So check this out.
Yeah, it's a lot better than a sandwich and a can of Coke, isn't it? Yeah, the Motorplex, I think, just lends itself to that environment so much better.
Yep. Yeah, I mean, we're lucky. I mean, it's not many junior sports that get to play with the big boys each week. And that's another thing why the kids learn a lot of respect, you know. And they, when they want to be kids, they can come hang out, and we're down in the back corner.
Yeah.
Got the grass, and, you know, it's great. And they love putting other kids through their cars, you know, showing it off and trying to encourage them, their parents, to spend a bit of money on their kids and say, come on, come join us.
So what's the age that you can start doing junior drags?
10 in WA.
Yep.
So unfortunately we still haven't got that back down to 8. And if we can, we can. But if we can't, we can't. But we'll get there eventually, hopefully.
Do you think there's, like, maybe, yes, I guess not for now, you know, to get that interest in that younger group? Is there maybe something that could be developed to get, you know, like, there's carts, you know, I mean, they're a bit ridiculous, but, you know, in terms of, you know, something sort of similar where you can do is that little step before hitting the main track?
Yeah, it'd be nice if there was, and if we could get something like that, but unfortunately there's nothing there at the moment. And I suppose that's one of my pet peeves is, you know, with any sport, the juniors are the development and the upcoming future of any sport. And the longer they're held out of being able to come in at a younger level, they're going to find other interests. Yeah. So if they want motorsport and they're 8 years old, they can go and get a kart, but they can't get a junior dragster at the moment.
Yeah. What about that the ramp that leads towards the scrutineering area at the Motorplex? Like, maybe we could set up some little, you know, like billy cart races or something. Or something like that.
Yeah, sort of, no, it'd be cool.
Box cars
straightway, no motors involved, you know, just...
Yeah, there's got to be something out there one day that we can get them in there and get them playing.
And your upper age is what?
So 17 in Andra. So on the East Coast, there's another sanctioning body which allowed them to go to 18. But as much as the parents would like to keep some of their kids in the juniors for another year or two, because they're getting licenses and cars and some are going on to further studies, it would be cheaper to keep them in juniors for another year or two. But I'm soon finding out now that Zara's, you know, they enjoy juniors, but they do want to get that bigger engine and go faster and have more fun.
The turning 17, so is that turning 17 in the year, or is that
if they start a season at 16, they can race till the finish of that season, but if they're already 17, they step up.
That's pretty cool then. In terms of the actual cars themselves, we call them cars.
They're dragsters, they're cars. Yeah, they've got four wheels.
Yeah. I just don't want to, you know, offend anyone out there in dragland by calling it something, you know. I can't remember what I called something the other week.
Formula whatever it is.
The formula whatever it is. But, that's their own fault. Did you know in Collie, they drove through one of our interviews deliberately?
Oh, really?
Yeah, and I swore at them, but I cut it out of the final. Because that was actually a client interview, so I actually had to.
We had the MRP meeting the other night, and Chris is new to it. And I'm like, man, this thing has been going on for 3 years about that category. Don't worry.
So I try not to offend anyone. The formula whatever's on over, they can just deal with it. I'm just going to keep calling that from now on. So the cars, you know, what are they essentially? You know, they just cut down versions, or, you know, what are they?
They are a half-scale.
They're getting too technical because his thunder.
Yeah, they are a half-scale dragster, effectively, and I think Zara's car's like 4.1 metres long.
Yep.
Runs a single-cylinder side valve engine, which they all do. The engines have got to be a single-cylinder side valve engine to make the category. And they start off at a smaller, based on a Bridge and Stratton Raptor engine, which is your 5.5 horsepower engine, which you find on most edges these days. And then they move up into the billet versions, which Zara's running a 3.75. It's about 76 horsepower, roughly.
So, what's the sort of top speed you get out of
136 kilometres an hour in the big car. So,
what's a go-kart?
Depending on what you get. The go-karts, you're so varied in your categories.
Yeah.
But, you know, like you're saying, having go-karts out there, it's kind of a shame because some of the, you know, the 125s and that, there's screen, but I don't know what the top out of gearing is.
The gearing
drag racing is a whole different art form.
Yep,
because it comes a lot more into gearing, tire sizing, that sort of stuff.
Probably should have done more research on that before I asked a question about the top
speed. We did some dirt carts one day, and as a family, and Zara was upset because she wasn't allowed to race in the 150cc dirt car. She's like, what, Junior's 500 and something cc? You know, like, seriously.
There's no race carts that are that big. Unless you go to a supercar, but they're not really that common over here.
Yeah, okay. All right, cool. In terms of the, you know, obviously they're developing, the juniors are developing in life and all that sort of thing. And, you know, we probably remember some of our years back then, you know, as long as you're not as old as Brent. Exactly. Just sit there, Grandpa. Sip your tea.
Whip the horse.
Yeah. how do you handle the, you know, like the highs and the lows of drag racing, you know, with, you know, developing, you know, brains and emotions, you know, that they're already going through, and then they hit puberty, which is a whole new level of thing. And I think, you know, boys, I think, tend to go the more like indestructible path, and I'm going to get shot, I know, for saying this. Girls maybe, you know, a bit more emotional.
Yeah, some of them. No, you haven't met Zara.
Some of them. Yeah. Some of them. I shouldn't generalise here because I will get shot.
No, I think it, oh man, drag racing is a brutal sport. Like, there is no more sport more brutal. Like, if once you're out of qualifying, if you don't win, you're on the trailer. So, you know, it teaches them to be good losers and good winners very, very quickly. And because they are all mates, they are good winners and they are good losers. So, you know, there's no real hissy fits. And 9 times out of 10, if they are having a hissy fit, it's more at themselves because they've cut a bad light or, you know, they've done something wrong themselves with no external pressure on them to do better. But it's more what they, the pressures they put on themselves.
Okay.
Yeah.
How do you manage the time, you know, between school and, you know, drag racing and other hobbies?
Oh, look, I'm an Uber dad. Yep. So I love drag racing season. I get to slow down.
Okay.
Yeah, Zara with her soccer is just off the charts. So we'll talk about that later, I suppose. But, yeah, yeah, the drag racing is great. It's we do a little bit during each meet. There's not a lot of maintenance to do on them. If we don't break them, that's a great thing about this sport. There's very little to do in between rounds, and why we when we were looking into motorsport, because Zara had a real desire to drive something, and we looked at junior speedway because we were speedway spectators for a long, long time. And the bashing and the crashing didn't really seem that much fun to me. I'm popping panels and wheels and all that damage. So, but not for me, but it is for other people, and that's what they get out of it. So we always call the speedway the dirty side and the drag racing the clean side. So we went the clean side, and, yeah, we like to have that little bit shinier show-type car and make the Dragster look pretty and pretty it up between rounds and keep it running right. You got a little bit of maintenance with the springs and stuff just to keep the consistency of the car. And, yeah, so then we all go to the track and hang out as a family, and that's what we love about it, you know. You're locked in. The grandparents get down, the aunts, the uncles and that, and we're there from 8 o'clock in the morning till, you know, sometimes sun up the next day. So you wouldn't think so, but we are. So.
Who are some of the... I guess standouts that are racing at the moment with you guys? I know we've got Brody Zappia took out last year's championship.
Yeah, back to back.
And Zara second.
Zara was second. Yeah. She managed to claw that back.
Yeah. I have to admit, I was in the stands that night. You know, it sort of was so worn out, and I was just up in the stands, and I was like, I was actually cheering for Zara. I was like, come on, like, you know, just yeah, it would have been nice. I was just yeah, after sort of you know. Briefly meeting her and that. And,
yep.
You know, just like, yeah, come on, do it. Stick it to the boys.
Yeah, no, that's definitely one of her motivations for this season, being her last season, is she's actually won a runner-up Australian championship as well as 2 times now runner-up champion in WA. So she wants that top step. She's sick of being second. So.
Yep.
But in saying that, Lucas Green, he can cut a lot. Dylan Spadaro, he's coming up and coming. I think he finished 4th this year, and he just got pipped by Lucas and Zara as well. So there's plenty of talent there, and, you know, we had the unfortunate problem of ordering a brand-new part, and the clutch spring gave me grief, and it was a brand-new part. It took us 2 meetings to get on top of that, and that's probably what cost us the championship. So, you know... Again, those $20-$30 parts, you know, you do it as maintenance where you think, in hindsight, I should have just left it.
So. Wait until the end of the season. Yeah, I'm sure circuit racers, especially this one, will agree about parts and stuff. So
it's the last thing you check, you know, because you think you've just put a brand new part in, so it's going to be perfect. So not to be the case, but it is what it is.
Yep. Brent.
Yeah. I don't know bugger all about Junior Jackson.
Well, there you go. Now's your chance to find out.
Sorry, I watched a little bit of it growing up in New Zealand. It's sort of starting to come to a thing when I was sort of out of school, but grew up in Hamilton and had a few friends there that were drag racers. Tynan's one of them, so there was a few kicking around. But So the, would you say the quarter scale?
Half scale.
Half scale of an actual dragster itself. Are they built here in Australia, or are they frame kits you bring in, or how does it work, that side of it?
Some people have built them here in WA themselves, Norm Butler.
Yeah.
Famous chassis builder over here. He's built a lot of juniors. I think Gary Fowler built a few. A few people have brought them over from the States and built them up themselves, and there's a few, you'd say, homemade jobs around. Yeah. But these days, most of them are coming in from the States. Mike Boss chassis, JR chassis, motivational tubing chassis.
Yeah.
All chrome molly. They're just works of art. They really are engineering works of art these days. Yeah. Like even the back end from Zara's car, which I think is a 2012, if I'm right, is a full tube car. And now if you go and look at Brody's car, they've got a lot of machine flat bar aluminium where the back end's made in them, and they're just, they're sensational.
Like,
they are just, you know, we went through some stuff and got a lot of people saying they're just people welding up bits of tube in the shed at home. It's far from it. They are they are absolute engineered pieces of art.
Yeah.
And they're really cool.
Yeah, and that's what I don't think a lot of people appreciate. They get into it that Speedway, likewise as well, that when you get to that level, something that's a purpose-built race car, so like a street stock, yeah, cool, got a lot of work to do that, to get into that car, but then you go to like a sprint car or a QT or a speed car, or go from like a, you know, a production-based drag car to a rail or, you know, a dragster or a altered purpose-built race cars. The amount of stuff that they change that you just oblivious to is kind of cool to sit back and watch.
Yeah, if you ever get the chance and get into the pits and see some of those cars with their skins taken off, it's pretty awesome, the engineering that goes into those things.
Yeah, and it's, you know, like I've got two little ones and this one trying to figure out what they want to get into. What I like about the junior dragsters and what I like about some of the other forms of racing, when you get into a purpose-built race car, it's so much easier to work on than anything production-based. There's no limitation. Everything's designed to be put together and pulled apart really quickly.
Yep.
So you're saying there's very little maintenance to do between rounds. It's probably more than you think. It's just it's quite easy to do, because once you've got the car up on stands and the panels works off it, you can get to everything.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, makes it easier to work around. So you mentioned something that sort of turned me on a bit there. So the bigger engines, the billet.
Yeah.
So who turns them up over here?
No one, unfortunately. So they're all coming from the States as well. Nick Woods builds a really good engine. Mike Boss, not Mike Boss, sorry. The name escapes me now. It's going to kill me. It's going to haunt me. JR engines, they're all really good engines. They're, as I say, fascinating to watch if you ever get on YouTube and watch them turn out a billet engine. That's to think that it's come from a cast base model of something that's bolted to an edger, and then they're just blown up bigger, better, shinier.
Yeah.
And prettier. Some are anodized and all different colours and whatnot to match the race car. As I say, they turn into show cars pretty quickly.
That's proper cool. So they you just buy an engine over in a crate, or like if you have to rebuild it, you package up, send it back, or
outside
of billet blocks, the machining's a little bit special. Well, not special, but it's, you get one chance.
Thankfully, we haven't put a rod through. We've seen people put rods through engines and stuff like that. So they can be welded and fixed, of course. But we do get all our parts in. And then we, Rick Wood builds our engine, rebuilds our engine for us. And Aaron Deary helps out as well. There's a few engine builders around Perth that will do the maintenance on them and look after them. So, there's... Once you get them here, getting the parts over, other than the whole COVID thing, getting stuff out of the States at the moment, it's a nightmare. Everyone's having that problem, no matter what category you're in.
Absolutely.
It can get sorted here. So.
Oh, that's cool. That is proper cool. And what do they run on? Just petrol? Are they on?
We're on methanol.
Methanol, so they are on methanol.
On methanol. Okay, Hence the reason the extra safety gear the kids have got, where they're all SFI, everything's SFI.
Yeah, it's big multi-layer being methanol.
Yep. So, yeah, absolutely. We know you sort of understand why the suits and that are a little bit more expensive than karting and stuff like that, but you need it.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, well, like a karting suit, you can get quite cheap and cheerful, but they're designed for abrasion and that's it.
Yep.
They're not designed for, how much fuel are they holding in a
junior? I think Zara's tank's about 500 mil, 700 mil. They're only running for about 30-odd seconds at a time, so by the time they start up, get to the end of the track and turn around. So.
Cool. And you mentioned getting stuff out of the States. I assume that tyres are all out of the States as well?
Yep, they're all custom. We use Hoosier.
Yep.
I prefer the Hoosier, but Mickey Thompson's another brand, Pitbull. So, it's huge in the States, absolutely huge.
Massive.
It's quite expensive to bring a car over if you want to get a full car, so you try and buy a car locally and that, but you look at the prices of stuff in the States and it makes you want to cry. Yeah. So, a car that'll cost, a top-end car over there, you could get for under 10 grand US. Over here, you're looking at 15 to 20.
And that's just the population density of people there. So even what might be considered a minority sport, it's a big minority. So there's
huge.
A lot more stuff.
Absolutely huge over there, and they'll race, they'll go to the track and they can pay $5 or $10 US and go down and race after school.
There's
so many little tracks around, so it's a massive sport, even though it's only a small sport.
Yeah, that's kind of cool to think. So how does that work for, I know at Speedway you have Wednesday night practices, how does it work for the clean side?
So unfortunately we run when the big boys run.
Yeah.
So any test and tunes, you get an opportunity to put more laps on. That's probably the only downside, but it's good to, Motorplex got the Fast Series running again this season, so.
Fast Fridays. Yeah,
Fast Fridays. Looking forward to that. Can't wait. Well, Zara will get some laps this year on her last season, so, with, I think there's 4, 5, maybe 6 Fast Series on top of a 9-10 event calendar.
Yep.
So, they get to put some laps down. It's good.
Oh, that's cool. Yeah, the calendar's absolutely huge for the Plex this year. It's incredible.
Yeah, no, it's awesome. It's back to where it was a few years ago, so.
Yeah, well, the Fast Friday thing was long before my time in WA, and when they did one end of the season last year, or this year.
Yep.
End of the last season, it was just a cool idea. So, looking forward to that. So what about, obviously reaction times, everything with the dragster, cutting a light, as you say.
Yep.
How do they get practice for that? Do you do the traditional button and tree setup, or do you go into that, or fire it up in the driveway and, hope the neighbours don't mind you leaning up in their driveway?
Every now and then, we fire up at home and let the neighbours know that we're home. Yeah. But other than that, Zara does a lot of stuff on the tree and just getting in and out of the car and just sitting in the car and playing with the pedals type deal.
Yeah.
It's just one of those sports where, unfortunately, you just can't go and put it out on the street and have a burn because...
it doesn't work that way.
The boys in blue are too...
I mean, you could.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, it's very frowned upon.
Yeah, that's it. So you do the right thing and... the practice tree and stuff like that. And Zara's a goalkeeper.
Yeah.
In soccer, so a lot of her reflex stuff comes from another sport, really.
Oh, that's cool. That is probably cool. And is she, it's obviously Andrew's section, so is there a golden tree for the juniors? Is it
they've got a Western Nationals as a golden tree, then the Golden States as a silver.
So they're pretty covered, it doesn't matter what level of racing you're doing, that is like the best thing in the world.
When there's this Andra sanctioned when Summit Series.
Yep.
So that's a tree event. So we're lucky in WA, we get two of those. So Zara's got one here in WA, one over in Portland.
Yeah.
And also one with the other sanctioning body in Sydney. So she's got three trees from meets plus the runner-up.
Yes, so that's pretty wicked.
So,
that's fair pretty cool. Ball of trophies. Like
they're incredible. Level. It took her a while to realise and appreciate it.
How special they are.
Because, there's people in the sport that
haven't you go been whole in life and not be able to get
yeah.
one.
Yeah, yeah. Friends of ours who I started crewing with, Tony Woods, like they got their first tree, and they've been racing for years and years and years.
Yeah.
So yeah, it's pretty special when they get one.
Yeah, I had that exact conversation with another mate, Chris, on the way here. We're arguing about the importance of a championship versus special events. So like with circuit racing, we don't have something as prestigious as the tree, but most categories have a special one-off perpetual trophy, you event. Know, being it named after someone or an older event that's just managed to keep going. They keep it as one perpetual trophy each year. And there's pros and cons to that style, but to me those perpetual trophies are pretty special. So a tree sort of is in that.
Like, I suppose, supercars with Bathurst, you know. Everyone wants a Bathurst. Yeah.
And there's a lot of people that throw a season away to win that.
Yeah. And people have won championships and not won a Bathurst and would do anything to have that Bathurst.
Yeah, 100%. So, yeah, no, that's really, really cool. Does Zara get into the maintenance at all? Does she learn, like, is she mechanically minded? Does that teach her a bit of that?
Yeah, and she's stepping that up too. She's got a couple of model V8 engines now. Now we've got the big car. She's wanting to know the ins and outs of the big engine as well, so... But trackside with the junior, she gets in the maintenance. She's got her duties. She does cleans her tyres and gets all her tyre prep done as well as her data.
Yeah.
They're at that age, you know, Brody, Zara. Those older kids are right into getting their data, pulling the data off. And it's good for us parents because they pick their own dial in, so we don't get yelled at the other end when they are. Oh, yeah. when the dial in number's not right.
Yeah,
but in saying that, Zara and I sit down and we do talk about it, and we see what the weather's doing, the car's doing, and work out from the data what we should try and dial in.
Cool.
So a lot of the kids, are they all get into the working on cars as they start getting older, or do some of them sort of get pampered a little bit?
There's not too many steering wheel attendants.
Oh, good.
That's what we call the ones that just like to Hollywood. They start off that way. Look, and you get it. The kids are there to get in the fun and drive and go fast and as they're allowed and have fun and catch up with their mates. And, you know, they don't want to get into the maintenance on that early. And then later on they start getting more and more and more involved.
Yeah, they realise it all works together.
Yeah.
So with the data, what do they have? Is it like a race pack or an aim or a...
So they run a micron.
Oh, yeah, it's like a micron, like a cart.
So the drag racers have a micron 660, which is just designed for straight line.
Yeah.
So they get their engine temp, head temps, their exhaust temps, wheel RPM and that sort of thing. So then we can go back and see what the engine was doing with the weather and... whether they've had any clutch slippage or anything like that.
That's wicked. So you use the AIM suite for that then?
Yep.
Cool. Good bit of software there.
No, it's a great little bit of software and, it takes a lot of the guesswork out.
Yeah, that's cool. So do you do, as far as tuning goes with the engine, do they, you said you're talking about air and that obviously methanol and...
Yep.
How's that side of it work? I'm not sure, is it a normal little... Venturi type carburetor, like on a...
They've got a side carburetor, the McCoonies.
Yeah.
Like on the bikes. So bigger the engine, the bigger the carb you've got. Zara's got a 42mm McCoonie on hers. And that's the engine builder I was thinking of, Crawls. And with the Crawls carby. And so we can change jets. Change head temperatures, change the amount of methanol, changes head temperatures and all that sort of thing by changing the amount of fuel going in, changing the heat in the engine.
Yeah. Yeah, and with the way the weather swings down there, that's pretty important.
Yeah, run it fat, keep it happy.
Yeah. Yeah, that way you don't have to worry about putting one of those legs outside of the block and trying to find another one.
Yeah, it looks pretty spectacular at night when they get into the finals and they're running little blue flames out the back of the door, so it's pretty cool.
Yeah, they'd love that. What about, obviously you said you like making them pretty, do you guys get into the paintwork side of it or?
We've got an awesome guy on the East Coast, Jason Maggs, runs M-Print, does all our vinyl wraps.
Oh yeah, so it's all wraps.
His is all wraps and it's pretty cool. So Jason's done all the design of her helmet and stuff. We throw a few ideas at him and
It just goes hard.
Exceeds our expectations. It's amazing what they can do with vinyl these days. It's just incredible.
Yeah.
So, but she's got the parachute on her car.
Yep.
So last season she only pulled it about six times, but this season, yeah, as long as it's safe and the wind's right, she'll be pulling that probably 90% of the time. Because get used to the big car again. This is a training ground for the big car. Yeah. So. She'll be on the chute a bit more, so it'll look a bit more spectacular. It's not really needed for the speed they're doing and the size of the plex. They've got that much runoff,
yeah.
You know. So, but it does look pretty cool when she pulls the chute on that thing, I must admit.
Yeah, no, that's probably cool.
Do the do you guys do any sort of like come and try days? Are you able to do those or not allowed to do those?
Yeah, unfortunately, that's not one of those things. It's easy to do with Junior Dragster. It's... because there's such a licensing process that, it does make it really difficult to do that. But we do encourage people to come down the pits, come down what is normally the sprint car bay at the Plex, and we're on the bottom end on the grass, and bring your kids down and have a talk to us, put you through the cars, run through it. Especially if we've been knocked out, you know, put you in the car and push you around the paddock, whatever.
Yeah,
fun.
Yeah. So that's the best way. Just get people there hanging out and just understanding how the day rolls. Yeah, it's not, you know, like carts that come and try it.
That's what I just...
pretty controlled.
You know,
but,
obviously, I'm thinking, there is only one seat, so, the same in go-karts, really. In carts, and there's some two-seaters, but,
yeah.
I think when we talked to Tall Tony, he was saying that it's only... they just chuck them in and let them go.
Yeah. You organise on it when they're having a practice day. We're kind of lucky... we get a lot of opportunities in the carts and circuit. You can hire the track whenever you want, as long as you've got a first aider with you.
Yeah,
which is pretty ludicrous, especially when you start knocking some of these sports sedans around with you. Some pretty silly stuff on tuning days.
Yeah.
You don't do silly stuff on tuning days.
No, I don't do silly stuff on tuning days. But no, we...
no.
Yeah. Friends of turn seven.
No, it's not like the big ones too, where you can go and talk to the putlins and... sit in the three-seaters,
they're incredible.
Have a scream down that. I'm yet to do that.
Oh, man, you've got to have a try, man. They are, first time I saw one of those, nearly two of them together, but first time I saw one, they just blew me away. They are incredible. And then Kyle's now got a real dragster, like a... those three-seaters are real dragsters, but like the...
he's got a fuel car.
Yeah, fuel top car. Fuel. And it's just the most mental thing I've ever seen. Like, the... whoever came up with doing that as a form of motorsport is just tapped. Like, you know, we're pretty lucky to have some of them in Australia. There's not a lot of them.
Yep.
You know, I'm not a drag racing guy, but if I, you know, if COVID all lifts and we get back to the States, I'd love to go see just a show. Because,
my goal would be to get over to Vegas and go and see them four wide. See
Top man.
Top fuel four wide would just be insane.
Yeah, no, it's just next level. But, and even like... Kyle's altered. Like, that thing is, you know, he's done what he wanted to do with that, and it's parked up in the corner now. But that, to me, that's an incredible machine.
Absolutely.
Like, I just, but that's the sport. It is mega. So, that's kind of cool. So how many categories of the Junior Dragster? So the first one's got the OEM type motor.
Yep, the small one. So C Junior.
Yeah.
They run the little engine, so they're limited to 1190.
Yeah.
And they qualify on a 12-second run. So, but, you know, it's bracket racing, so your car is only as fast as you need it to be, as long as it's consistent.
Yep.
So they're fast. I think their top speed's around 72 kilometres an hour. And then you step up to the Bs, and they run a 860 and an 850 now, so they can go as quick as 850, but dial in on an 860 and run roughly about 120 kilometres an hour.
Yep.
And then they step up to the big A cars, which 790, and these are all 8 mile with an 80 quali.
Yep.
So around 136, 137 kilometres an hour.
Pretty quick. Yeah.
Yeah, not bad. I mean, Zara's roughly 1.67 to the 60 foot.
Yeah,
so that's a single cylinder. It's
it's not bad,
it's proper cool, and you know, I've got a great shot. from one of the photographers, Phil, down at the thing with Zara, got the tire crinkle and everything on, yeah, on the Junior. You know,
it's cool.
Unreal.
Yeah,
I love Phil. Phil's.
Yeah. They pick a wheel up, or they.
You can soften the chassis up. There's a couple of photos floating around from the States where you, because you got torsion bars and stuff like that, so you can really soften the chassis up so they can lift the front wheel. Yeah,
yeah.
I'm pretty sure I've got one of the Juniors lifted a little bit.
Yeah,
well, it wasn't like a. Big thing, enough to just go off it.
Because dragsters are all about that control and that movement. The design, the chassis are designed to move and do certain things. That's cool. No, I'm just pumped for Fast Fridays because we'll be there running. Family's going to come run. So
cool.
Yeah.
Well, come down and see us.
The boys down to see you for sure.
Yeah, put him in the car and get some photos and have some fun.
The progression after Junior Drags, what's the pathway? Is there a sort of set pathway where you go from
budget?
Budget? That's budget? Yeah, okay.
Yeah, there's a lot of ex-juniors in Superstroke.
Okay.
Zara's going to step into modified. Casey McClure has stepped into modified. And you spoke about Madison earlier. She looks like she's going to go a lot quicker than that.
Yeah.
So
The Boston Strangler, is that the Boston Strangler?
They've also bought another car, I believe.
Yes, I've heard that one as well. Yeah,
so
they're actually coming on soon.
Supercharged Outlaw as well, I think. Yeah. Not 100% sure, but as I say, your budget's pretty much and how you want it. your child to progress, I suppose.
Yeah. Just interesting, because you see in, circuit racing, you can do the, dad's budget thing, but generally there's that progression of, this level of cars to that level, and then they go into Formula V's, Formula Fords, and, then decide, they stay there or do they go tin top and that. So there's a bit more of that progression path where, there is absolutely, Chase Hoy went straight from karts to tin top.
Yep.
You got some guy like Denver who never raced in a kart and went straight to, when tarmac rallying in a WRX. No, it was his Ford Laser, TX3.
Jim Carnes and stuff.
Which is when I met him. There's some people that don't do that route. So it's just interesting to know, if there is sort of a generic path or, it is just dad's money generally.
Yeah, and look,
Or mum's.
Yeah, mum. Or mum can't forget controls mum. It. So
yeah,
and there's families that have awesome family. The Westerns, Shane went straight out of juniors into the alcohol dragster. So not because they're super rich or anything, but they worked bloody hard and made it all happen, and that's the path they wanted. So you can go as simple as going to a street car and slowly going through. We chose the modified because you can spend 60, 70 grand on a street car.
Oh, easy.
And, especially on a HSV or a Holden like we would, Team Red. And, you can spend half that and buy a purpose-built race car. So yeah,
that's easy to work on. Yeah.
The big car will do a 7 and... have some fun.
Nice. Cool. Well, have you got anything else on Junior Dragsters?
No, I was just, you mentioned about the, I always ask about the emotion of sport, it's pretty hard to, that one's...
I do apologise for saying the girls are generally more emotional.
Oh, no, it's at all ages.
I don't mean to say like that. There's a certain thing I was trying to get at and I've completely stuffed it up and I'm going to get castrated when I get home.
it's a general thing. Most boys are pretty rambunctious and want to run off. You get others,
Oh, look, if Zara's cut a nasty light, she's told us, don't come and talk to me for 10 minutes. Let me do this thing. But it's an emotion, but it's not a girly...
At least it's kind of cool that she's learned to be able to manage it by saying, hey, look, I need 10 minutes just to yell at my own helmet.
And not do...
you get in my face.
Yeah.
not do drop kick from...
Yeah. Yeah, not throw torque wrenches at your old man.
And that shows a level of maturity in the kids.
That is really cool. Because And the, you know, you said drag racing is a really cool sport because you get knocked out of qualifying. I mean, I think motorsport in general, sometimes you can have like everything stacked in your favour and then that clutch, $20 clutch spring or whatever it is, it, just a dumb straighter valve on a tyre, or you just have something dumb fail that's beyond anyone's control and couldn't, and doesn't matter how many checks you do,
yeah,
it just doesn't go your way.
No.
And trying to figure that in your own head without getting really upset, you know, you grab a rugby ball and you run, you trip over, and fuck, you tripped over, dude. You know, like,
and with most motorsports, you know, if you mess up one corner, you got 5-6 other corners to make up. With drag racing, if you drop a tenth on the line,
that's it.
You ain't making it up. Every parent pretty much down there has got a handle on the cars, and those, I mean, we've got a small group of kids there, but those cars and the kids, they're just so switched on. It's awesome.
Yeah,
it's a really tough sport.
So besides coming down to Motorplex on drag nights, where can people find out more information about Junior Dragsters?
Check out the West Coast Junior Dragster page on Facebook and check it all out there, and we'll post if we're doing any displays, static displays. We'd try and get out and look after people that look after us and put the cars on show. And from the junior page, there's always, or WADRA, even through WADRA, West Australian Drag Racing Association, people will get in touch with you and give you all the information that you want, and
nice,
try and hook you up with a car and come down and, or hook up with a team first and come and spend the day with the team and have some fun and just see how family orientated it is.
All right, well, we're going to wrap up with you with the Junior Dragster Association stuff, and we'll get you back on another time to have a bit of a chat about all things Ian Board and
future drag racing
and the future of drag racing in your family and all that sort of stuff.
Cool.
All right. Episode 7.
Got it right this time.
Got it right, finally. Done, dusted, and see you next time.